Oké. Okay. Je kunt hier aan. Ja? Oké. Okay. Well, I will try to do my best. There will be some repeats with the previous talks, and but I will skip these and try to fill in as much as possible what has been missing. So you have pathogenic and saprophytic leptospirals. The saprophytic leptospirals live in the environment. They do not cause disease. Pathogenic leptospirals require a host, and they live in usually in the kidneys, but also in the genital tract. For example, a cattle might have more leptospirals in the genital tract than in the kidney. We talked about sexual transmission, but that certainly is an issue. So they, we already know that, they live in a variety of animal species, mammalian species, and they are excreted with the urine into the environment where they have to survive for some time. And they survive longer if conditions are favorable. That means that it is humid, moderate to warm, neutral, slightly alkaline environment, which means, which implies that leptospirosis is dominant in tropical and subtropical countries. So, from the environment, because that's the main, it's not the only, but it's the main infection route, people get affected by consumption of, this was also in the discussion, by consumption of water. There are some examples of outbreaks because people were drinking water from contaminated sources, or drinking contaminated water, labor, which puts them at risk, or simply living in an environment where there are a lot of leptospirals around. So these leptospirals have to adapt to a host. They have to survive in an environment, and they have to survive at least for some time also in the incidental host. And that is reflected in a high flexibility or plasticity of the genome. This adaptation of leptospirals, and you can see it in this ACT diagram, which is there are two chromosomes in leptospirals. These chromosomes have been linearized, and then the scan draws a line from one gene on one genome to the same gene on the other genome. These are closely related strains, and you already see that there is quite some rearrangements, and this is rearrangements between the species. So there is a lot of genetic mobility in the genomes. A high variety of leptospirals. There's a high wide variety of clinical manifestations. And there are trends of some cereviars causing mild or severe disease. But the same you can say for species. For example, the species Leptospira interrogans is more, tend to be more virulent than, for example, the species Arbor petersinae. It's quite complex. And we discussed this morning about the infection dose, which certainly is an issue. The way, the route of infection also. But I think also the virulence of the leptospira will be something to be taken into account. It's not a single factor, it's not a single factor, there are multiple factors. So cereviars are associated to certain hosts, and we need to identify infectious source by demonstrating the same leptospira in the host and in the patient. So diagnosis is not simple. There's a wide variety of signs and symptoms. There's a spectrum from mild to severe, potential fatal. And the leptospirosis certainly in acute phase mimics many other diseases. There are some clear syndromes like Weill syndrome with hepatorenal failure and hemorrhages, maybe cardiac disorders with a high case fatality rate. That's usually recognized by clinicians, but this form is only 10% of the total number of leptospirosis cases. Others are simply not recognized by clinicians, even in the Netherlands. Then we have the emerging severe pulmonary hemorrhagic syndrome. Case fatalities have been reported up to 70%, even 80%, say 50% case fatality rate. It's an emerging disease, and many clinicians are not aware of this and simply do not recognize this as leptospirosis. So we have to be aware that the majority of cases are not diagnosed on clinical grounds, and you need a laboratory. So this diagram, also from Chris Everhart, in the origin, in the origin, shows the infection and the humoral response dynamics. Incubation period has been reported from 2 to 30 days, but on the average it will be 1 to 2 weeks. After that, you develop fever. It can be biphasic, but for severe leptospirosis, mostly it's these phases are merged into one. We find leptospirosis in the blood during the first week, in the liquor a little bit later, in the urine for the convalescent shedder several weeks, and for the natural host it will be years, up to lifelong. So leptospirosis circulate in the blood, and they are removed from the blood by the humoral response. IgM comes up a little bit earlier than IgG. And if you want to do laboratory diagnostics, you can cultivate, and for cultivate you can also put PCR at the moment. You can cultivate from the blood at the acute phase, early acute phase. You can culture from the liquor, somewhat later from the urine. And serology does not contribute a lot during the first week of disease. Serology also always actually confirms afterwards.
Can I ask you a question? It's related to transmission. So, you know, patients, human patients with leptospirosis, they actually produce quite a bit of leptospirosis, live leptospirosis in Europe.
Yeah.
Right? Maybe 10 to the 6th probability there, sometimes higher.
Mm-hmm.
Yet, you know, looking back at the literature, there's actually been no documented case of nosocomial infection in many of these developing country settings in the hospital I worked in. You know, urine's all over the place. So why is it that, you know, that humans, if you're a cow, you can pretty efficiently transmit it to another cow body, urinating one on the other, well, one urinating on the other, but with humans, you don't have that. Well, first of all, do you agree with the phenomena?
Yeah,
the
yeah.
The second is there any plausible explanations?
Well, I think the explanations might be in the behavior. If someone in the family has leptospirosis and you wash your hands more frequently, it protects you against leptospirosis. Humans do not lick each other like animals do. So that there are a number of aspects why I think that while urine of a human patient is potentially infectious, infections are not reported frequently because of these differences in behavior. And besides, there are not, to my knowledge, not many investigations on how leptospirosis will spread within a household. Most questionnaires ask about the animals around and not about the patient. It, probably you did do some investigations like that in Salvador.
We've never seen, opposed to what you see in animals, we've never seen clustering cases within households. We've seen clustering of prior exposure, meaning that people have had similar past exposures, but at least we've never seen, you know, clustering of cases. And if you look, we're looking at the literature, I've never seen a case of this clustering.
Yeah, but also in infections that you find seroconversions within families?
Yes.
Okay, because if one on 150 infections lead to severe leptospirosis, then you can have infection without a case in a household. So
but it's not the
seems to be a major factor. Yeah. Sure, whether they multiply in the blood.
They actually, at least from animal models and also in humans, you can actually have quite high leptospirulins without symptoms. And then they reach some critical value, like, so you can get up to 10 to the 6th. And once you have 10 to the 6th, then you see these onset of symptoms, at least in animal models. And there have been some anecdotal work with human cases. Yeah. So they, you get, a, just like gram-negative sepsis, you get.
Yeah, but that does not necessarily mean that they multiply in the blood. Could be in the liver, for example. I'm not sure at this moment. So, diagnostic tests, conventional tests, I think dark field microscopy, so you can look at leptospirosis under the dark field microscope, which is very unreliable method. But it would be nice to look at the urine of a cow excreting leptospirosis, because it's very dense, it looks like a culture. There are many leptospirosis in the urine of an Harjo cow. And also here, Albert showed infection by the eye, which required high concentrations. But if a cow is urinating, it's urinating this kind of concentrations. And in the Netherlands, we had an outbreak of diary fever, and that was really direct contact from urinating cows to the farmers who were milking these cows. So, dark field microscopy, then we have the microscopic agglutination test, ELISA. There are several drawbacks on these methods. I'm not detailing them too much. Isolation is proof, is evidence of infection, but culturing takes 4 to 6 months, up to 4 to 6 months, and is not suitable for diagnosis for the individual patient, but it has an epidemiological value. Okay, so this is microscopic agglutination test. It's the gold or the reference standards. It has a trend towards silver specificity, but be very careful, because you cannot deduce an affecting silver from MET results. But it has a certain specificity, so you need representative serovars. And it might indicate, give an indication for the serogroup, not for the serovar. Then we have ELISA. What we do is IgM against leptospirosis, is a in-house ELISA. It's gene-specific, and we use dilution series because it made the test more robust. Okay, so MET is the gold standard, but if you look here, this is sensitivity, these are the tests. Here, DPO days post onset of disease. Serology does not contribute to the diagnosis at the first 4 days. Then we have an increase in the sensitivity. And if I look here, we have the MAT, and here we have the ELISA. ELISA is somewhat earlier positive than MAT, that's known. But that's not surprising here. But what is surprising is, if you look even here in the convalescent phase, the MAT never reaches a sensitivity that is higher than 80%. It's not as sensitive as you would expect. It's very specific, but it's not sensitive. And in veterinary application, it's even worse. So we have a gold standard, which actually is not gold.
These are human data?
Yeah. That's what I'm telling you. If you're looking at in animals, it's worse. If you have a 50% sensitivity, you can be happy.
And does that vary greatly across host species and cerebar pairs?
Yeah.
I mean, one of the nice things about a map is it's a functional assay, not just a biomass.
Yeah, I agree with that. Yeah, yeah.
Woody, that assertion, is that made on the analysis of paired serum? When you say MAT, if you have paired acute and convalescent, the sensitivity is only 80%?
You have to look at this. So here you have the MAT, here you have the ELISA. This is the combination of MAT ELISA results, which is in the early phases is actually ruled by the ELISA, not by the MAT. But when you use paired samples, this here, then the sensitivity. So if you can demonstrate the increase or the seroconversion, then your sensitivity is rushing up. So it's very important to have these paired samples. And that was also a point about why this fourfold increase in titer. That's because there is an uncertainty in the MAT of at least one step. So they said, well, if you want to be certain about this titer rise, at least you have to take into account two dilution steps. That's a fourfold.
So from your data, you know, it seems to me IgM ELISA is more sensitive, right?
Yeah. Yes. This in our hands, on the Dutch population, it is.
But this test can be replaced MAT test.
In our situation in the Netherlands, we can, and actually we are doing. But I do not know whether this would also be counted, for example, in Sri Lanka or in Indonesia. You have to find out how your tests are performing at a certain location, and has to reestablish your accuracy of the test over there and make a decision. This is what we did find in the Netherlands, on the Dutch population. Then you have the rapid tests. There are a number of them. Usually they are based on this lateral flow assay, but you also have agglutination tests. This one is not on the market anymore, but we did evaluate it. And recently, last year, I think, published this is PLOS NTD, comparative analysis. This is a little bit older slide with work that we did do with what the group of Albert Kohl did do with us. And you see the same increase in sensitivity to the time of disease. And there are a number of tests, and you can see that actually there's no significant difference between all these different tests. What we did find worrying, however, is this is one test followed through the time. And what you can see is that this specific test, but also other tests, show this high variation in sensitivity. And I suspect that this has to do with the production of the test. The quality assurance of test production is not very good at this moment. And this indicates that you constantly have to doubt on your rapid test on this diagnostic quality. If you have a new batch, basically you have to test it again.
One more question. Can you cross-absorb your sera, different sera bars, and then look at the decrease in ELISA binding, whatever, and in order to detect the probable sera bar infecting? So what I'm saying is you take your antigen, left spiral antigen, mix it with your sera, different left spiral antigens, then test them to see where the greatest decrease titer occurs. Can you use that as a reference value in incriminating one sera bar or another?
Well, it's never been used in that way. Take the cross reactivities, cross agglutinations. Certainly at the acute phase are that large that I doubt whether this would work. You still have a huge amount of cross-reactive antibodies against all other kind of seras. And I would say it's better to have a late convalescent serum sample, because that tend to be more seroval specific and might give you the same information. This extremely less trouble.
Oh yeah, just curious.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
What I was saying, following up that suggestion, you might lose a lot of sensitivity of the assay if you do the cross absorption and then following up with another test, because all the paradoxical reaction in the mat.
But I'm not sure whether you can solve it. So a paradoxical reaction in MET usually is used in the framework as having a higher titer against a serovar than the one that is infecting. But the basic definition of it is having a titer against a certain serovar which is not infecting, while you have no titer at all against an infected serovar. So that's the situation you have to face with this. It's very risky to deduce serovars from an MET. I cannot recommend it. At the best, a sero group.
Maybe just to make a comment why this is important, because it may get lost to people who are not much versed in people.
Just to make the comment why it's important, and this is fairly specific leptospirosis knowledge, but you know, because we have so many serovars, and there's specific, and correct if I'm wrong, in places particularly like Africa, Central America, where Cristina works, you know, the Sri Lanka, Thailand, Indonesia, there are multiple serovars. Mm-hmm. So many times you can get maybe five or six circulating serovars in the same place. And so you don't know, at least from the public health side, you don't know which one is the one which is causing disease. Mm-hmm. So many people will either do rodent, you know, they'll do trapping studies or isolation studies on they get all these serovars, but it's not clear which one is actually causing disease in humans.
That's correct. Okay, so for diagnostic purposes, because you have to start antibiotic treatment as early as possible, actually this is a diagnostic window that where we have to do the diagnosis. And serology does not work in this window. In this window works current molecular tests, amplification tests like NASBA, LAMP. We are currently working on RPA, which actually is a very good technique, and PCR. We have PCR in the diagnosis in our laboratory. And you can put them also in rapid test formats. Okay, so leptospirosis is a zoonotic disease. This is more or less a repeat of what I have told before. You need to identify the same strain of serovar in the patient and in the suspected animal reservoir or animal source. At this stage, this would require isolation and typing of leptospirals because you cannot deduce from the MET. You need to have the leptospira in your hand to do a proper analysis. And you can get information on suspected sources by asking the patient about contacts with potential infection sources. So, classification of leptospirals. There are two classification systems. The conventional one is based on serology. And then you have a newer one, about 1990s, which is based on DNA composition homology. Do not let yourself confuse by trying to make associations between these two systems. It's not possible. These are simply two different systems. They do not correlate. So I see many of the colleagues getting confused because they try to make associations between the two. Serological classification is one. Molecular classification is another. Keep them separated. That's the best way to deal with them.
I just asked before the molecular classification came along, should people feel one likes the classification for them to be useful, but also to be in some sense natural, to reflect some underlying biology?
Did people imagine that
the serological one did do that before the molecular one?
I still think so. I'm going to tell now. So, serovars are rather the species are associated with natural hosts. Everything is not absolute. These are trends. So we have the serovar hardio in cattle. But there are two serovar hardios, two types of them. One is Borg-Peter Sinai and the other is Interrogans. So in this case, there's no association between species and cattle. But there's an association between the serovar and the cattle. Talking about the aspect of virulence, be sure that this one causes more severe disease in humans than the Borg-Peter Sinai one. So speciation certainly is of importance. So here we have Interrogans serovar Copenhageni and Ictohemorrhagae that are practically confined to brown rats. This is Interrogans, but Canicula is also an Interrogans, and that's adapted to dogs. So again, you see here the serovar associated to a certain animal, but not the species. You mean one serovar changing in another serovar?
I just heard it earlier.
I think you
serovar. Yeah, there have been in the very.
Talking about convergent evolution.
In the very past, there have been investigations where they claimed that one CLR changed into another one, but that in the end that was caused by switching strains and by contamination. Actually, it has never been proven that one CLR changes into another CLR. Okay. So I made this in black because the CLR status is mainly based on the LPS composition. And there are a number of attempts to identify a CLR on base of molecular tools, but that's very tricky. Actually, there's only one way to do it, and that's have a molecular typing of CLRs based on LPS coding DNA. And some years ago, we showed in a pilot that it is possible. And as far as I can tell about the genome sequencing project, it seems to be clear that you can deduce CLRs from LPS coding DNA, and that will be the case in the near future. But as long as we do not have this tool, you have to do CLR typing by CLR typing and speciation by molecular typing. So you have the serological classification here. This is CLR as a basic plexin. That's determined by the reference test, the cross-agglutination absorption test. There you have your absorption. It's used to identify CLRs. And at this moment we have about 250 pathogenic CLRs grouped into 25 serogroups. So there's a serogroup 26 which at this moment has lost. And you need cultures for this. Then you have the molecular classification. You have species, 9 pathogenic ones, 5 intermediates, 6 saprophytic. There has been reported last year in 7 saprophytic species, Aldoni, but we are investigating it at the moment, and it does not look like a saprophytic species. It simply looks like an abdominis. Well, I think I do not completely rely on this publication. And then you have several ways to do the molecular typing. I'm not detailing these. So you have infection sources, infection reservoirs, which are not necessarily the same. And this is the famous picture. You have several of these transmission pictures, diagrams. This was already shown by Albert Koh. That's developed within the Delors, I think. This is from Solivane, which is also in many books. And here you can see the reservoir is where you maintain the infection between parents and offspring. Leptospirals are excreted by the urine. You have a direct contamination or infection of humans, but also a more important indirect one. Also, other animals become infected and they develop usually illness. But all these animals in itself can be a reservoir also itself. These also excrete the urine in the environment and infect humans, also infect humans directly, and also infect another reservoir. So the natural host, most mammal species can be a natural host, but the rodents are the most notorious ones, rodents and insectivores, but also have the other feral and domestic animals. There's a duck here. I don't know why they placed the duck there, but birds.
It's a bat.
It should be a bat. But birds are
not
the major factor in the epidemiology of leptospirosis. Sparrows. They have a higher body temperature. Leptospirosis do not survive in birds, except water birds. But still, if you see what they excrete, they leptospirosis do not survive that. Leptospirosis also have been found in frogs, toads, which might be reservoirs, but I'm not sure about that. Then you have the source of infection, and this is all not strict. You have a carrier, and you have a shedder. If you have a shedder, it's certainly a carrier, but if you have a carrier, it doesn't need to be a shedder. And certainly, cattle can be intermittent shedders. So if you take a urine sample and you do not find at a certain time and you do not find leptospirosis, it will not imply for certain that they are not there. You need to take several samples. So usually you have a maintenance host or infection reservoir, no disease, and you have accidental host which usually develop disease upon infection. For the pathogenesis, I had it in my title, but I do not spend too much time to it, because actually I simply do not know. But there are two things. There are groups looking at how leptospirosis behave when they come into contact with several hosts. And there are groups who investigate how hosts respond to infection with leptospirosis. But there's little investigation about the interaction. And actually, if you do not have the interaction, there's little to tell what's going on. We are trying to do some work with Jarl and Nelly, but at this stage, I simply do not know. We can tell that certain factors in the host are involved, like the TLRs, in innate immunity, and we know that a number of genes in the leptospirosis, distinct genes, are up or down regulated in the maintenance host versus the accidental host. And Jarl is using rats as a natural host and guinea pigs as incidental host. But I could not tell more about this, which might help you at this moment. So we have at this moment nearly 300 serovars which are recognized. Not all are reference serovars, but many are defined as a new serovar, and we have about 300. So I already told about the serovars associated to a certain host more than a species, but it's also the case that this is also more complex, because a serovar is usually adapted to a certain host, but you can have one serovar, more than one serovar adapted to one host. For example, pigs can carry Pomona, Parasophia, Bratislava, cattle can have Hardio or Pomona, dogs can have Canicula, but also increasingly Gripe tifosa. And you have one serovar that can be adapted to several hosts, Bratislava in pigs, hedgehogs, Gripe tifosa, common voles, hares, and dogs. And you do not have the conversion between serovars, but you have a constant process of serovars adapted to new hosts. So it's not a static situation, it's a dynamic situation. What you establish today might not be true in 10 years.
Can I just ask what you mean by adapted to the host? Because you've described to us that the serovars are defined, perhaps entirely defined or largely defined by the lipopolysaccharides, is that
yeah.
right?
Yeah.
Okay. Mm-hmm. So the lipopolysaccharides, but one imagines, I imagine, that adaptation to a host involves far, far more than the lipopolysaccharides, and yet you said that the cerevars then are kind of uncorrelated with much of the rest of the genome. It somehow doesn't add up to me. I mean, or I, at least I can't get my head, or perhaps you mean something else by adapting.
Yeah, but that's again because you are focusing on the leptospira and not on the host. There's something occurring in the interaction between the two. And LPS is not the only answer. It's one of the factors, but it's not the only one. And what is adapting and how it is adapting, I don't know, but what I know is that, for example, the cryptotyphosis in dogs is something coming up the last one or two decades. Before that, it was an incidental infection, and now you see more and more dogs carrying cryptotyphosis.
So looking at that,
their
carriers, they don't show clinical symptoms.
Yeah, asymptomatic carrier.
One question about it. The slide where you have the picture and you've got the rodent at the top, and then you have the rodent at the top, and then you have all the other animal species at the bottom. And I guess what I don't understand is it dogma or is it just that we've always seen it that way? Why aren't the rats with all the other species? Because in the cattle, don't we, like, do you ever see symptomatic infection in the rats?
No, they put them separately because they are the most notorious ones.
Is that historical? Is that because that's what we keep feeding ourselves, or is that actually reality?
Yeah, well.
Could it make a comment?
So I
think, you know, it's sort of like, I don't know if anybody knows the situation with leprosy. You know, you have tuberculoid and lepromatous, but actually the majority of cases are in between. So it's the same thing. You have, you know, the reason why it's always traditionally put on one side is because it seems like there's two poles. Mm-hmm. On one pole you have asymptomatic high-grade carriage, and on the other hand you have, you know, extreme susceptibility and no carriage. The other animals, you know, there's a continuum. And where that continuum is, and what animals are in that continuum, it's really not been systematically studied.
And do you not see that continuum at all in the rats? Because aren't there symptomatic?
Not really.
Rats?
I think almost all rat species that have been looked at, you know, and there haven't been really good systematic studies. But Jamie is the one who's been one of the first people to do this. You know, it's pretty asymptomatic. I mean, people looked at, you know, both lab infected, and they've looked in the wild. And such. So that's kind of, so it's still dogma,
right.
And a lot of it's not populated. I guess the reason why, but it goes down maybe to the question that Mike said, what's the basis of adaptation? So a lot of those, if you were to triage all of those incidental spillover events and just focused on what were the, you know, what are the maintenance hosts, you may see a different pattern. And, you know, we're not there yet. I don't think we've done enough systematic, but I guess the premise or the dogma is that it's really the rodents which were these evolutionarily these high, you know, the maintenance hosts,
right.
And that everything, all this other stuff that we're seeing, the dogs, the cattle, the pigs, hedgehogs, all, that's all incidental, but that's still that's a dogma. I don't think anyone knows.
But I think for many systems now, it's clear that that's not, like, in the day-to-day, year-to-year ecologies, right?
So I think that it's interesting to speculate. That does sound as though it's a plausible sort of deep history of Leptospira if rats and rodents really do have this general relationship with the pathogen. But in the sort of disease ecology nowadays, it's clear that there's some systems that are operating quite distinct from rodents, for instance, sea lions, that appear to just be able to sustain pathogen transmission within that system, and livestock systems as well. So I've always struggled a little bit with the nomenclature that's used within the field of leptospirology and how it relates to the way we use the same words in disease ecology. So terms like adapted, Mike, you heard it as I would hear it, as an evolutionary adaptation, and are there, you know, particular mutations occurring in the genomes of the pathogen that are causing it to become host adapted. And perhaps, I don't know if that is how you, what you think is going on at the level of, you know, on the timescale of a decade, as we see shifts in the distribution of serovars across host species. And it's great that we're entering the genomic era now, so hopefully we'll get answers to those kinds of questions. But it seems to me that some of those shifts are plausibly driven by ecological factors, and it may just be the invasion of a new type geographically into a different space. It may be a response to changes in how the host demography is operating or vaccination practices. I do think I'm fascinated by the divergence between the molecular classification and the serological classification, and the fact, you know, so they don't map onto one another at all, but there is, Albert mentioned convergent evolution, so it does appear that the LPS signatures on very different molecular backgrounds are converging on something similar, and that in turn, as you say, has a mapping onto which host species appear to function as maintenance hosts for those serovars. And so is that somehow selected? Is that interacting with the host immune system in some way that enables those LPS signatures to, you know, become chronic asymptomatic infections? And if so, how does that work for something like Pomona, which is in pigs and cattle and possums and raccoons? Like, what is the selective environment that's causing that convergence? And is it actually the same thing circulating, or is it just that some set of molecules happens to give the same MAT reactivity? I don't have answers to these things, but I do think it's really interesting, and it would be great as a field to try to wrap our heads around those things in a quantitative manner.
I wonder if from an evolutionary standpoint, whether they're kind of the stem host pathogen relationship would be the rat and its serovars, and then if you put the serovars on like some sort of, if you figure out what when divergence was through time, maybe these newer host-pathogen relationships where the reservoir host isn't asymptomatic throughout, you know, where you do see clinical infection, maybe those represent evolutionarily newer relationships, and that the rat just had more time to evolve this.
So maybe just then ask the question, how would we test, so there's 400 genomes that are sequenced now. The problem is that some of these are very old isolates, and it's not clear exactly. I think the community is working through this. How would you test that? So that's an important. Is that an interesting question?
Yeah.
I mean, how would you, now that we have these genomes, you could make some evolutionary inferences. You know something about how can we get out of this morass? The first thing Jamie said is, it's probably good. It might be a nice output of this to come up with a standard. Syntax or standard definitions of what we mean, because everyone in the field is so confused about what shedders mean, what carriers, maintenance hosts. We are all using it, what adaptation means. So I think that's great. But maybe the second work thing would be, how could we specifically test that? Because it sounds like it's something intrinsic about how we're going to understand why an epidemic happens in Sri Lanka or Thailand or such. So any thoughts?
There are 450 genomes.
I'm not a molecular ecologist, but and Jamie's probably better at expressing this stuff. But can't you use all these whole genome sequences and do a phylogeny and then place it within the context of a molecular clock and get some sense of when there was divergence, and like looking at relatedness, you can figure out when there was divergence and see what the most ancient strain might be.
Don't look at me on that.
anyone here have any background in this?
The biggest problem would be we don't have many isolates. You know, nobody is trying hard enough to get isolates, so we don't have isolates from different periods of time. For example, for Harjo, Bob Petersen, probably the last time it was isolated in U.S. was in 1990s, then we are now trying to get more isolates. They have isolates till 1990. I think they were all before 1990. And then there are some sea lion isolates, right?
Yeah.
So remember that we're having lunch all together in one small room.
Not done by myself, but the group we're working with is to try to get at that issue is with the 450 genomes is we're tracking down where all the isolates came from and doing some phylogenetic. I don't know if you know Forrest, you probably know Forrest Crawford, who so with Forrest trying to do some phylogeographic analyses to see if you can infer anything. For example, we know that there are certain species which are located in certain continents, like Noguchi is in the Americas. So if any of that, you know, how to say it, for example, if that divergence flows with the land bridge, you know, in the Americas, but those are all, I mean, kind of, how to say it, they're not direct ways of testing the hypothesis, but that's kind of one thing that it's been on the table. But if there's anything better to do to address that question, because it is this kind of central question, what is the central reservoir? Is there a central reservoir? Is all those diagrams that we've been publishing in books for the last 60 years, are they all just kind of, you know, ad hoc, you know, preconceived notions?
Let me close this with the following remarks. Well, rats were the first animal where they found lepus spires, and so that's the first association. It's also often called rat disease, also lepus spirosis. You have a number of species. You have nine pathogenic species. You have three species, lepus spira interrogans, Kirsteneri, and Borg-Peter-Sinai, which are spread all over the world. And these are mainly rodent-associated species. And I can imagine that they have been easily distributed by trade or whatever, very early trade already. Then you have two species, Santa Rosa and Noguchi. They are confined to the Americas. And you have Riley, that is Spira Riley, which is confined to Southeast Asia. So you have a certain, you can see in speciation, you can see certain patterns about distribution of the species. And maybe the focus is also on the rodents because these are the species you find everywhere. And then about the LPS, if you look at the attempts to get mutations in the LPS, very few mutations are produce viable lepus spires. It's very difficult to make mutations in the LPS coding region. So probably, maybe, the LPS coding DNA has a completely different evolutionary clock than other genes. So, go to the next. Okay, that's, you need surveillance. Transmission, we had it. So the transmission is often related to times in the year, but not always, often, and not consistently, raining, harvest season, heavy rainfall, flooding, and it's a seasonal disease, late summer, autumn, you have a peak. Risks, you already, let's see these cartoons.
Sorry, Rudy, I stole your...
No, transmission was in your presentation, not in mine. But I would like to show this picture and actually end, maybe end with this. You have several risk groups, which I have listed here. This is an investigation done by ILS, 2000-2003. And what you can see is most cases in the world are the farmers. Oh, there's an increasing trend towards urban lepus spirosis, but in this evaluation you can see that most of the cases still are farmers. That's not because farmers are especially high at risk, but there are simply many farmers in the world. So this is why we are here. There is no, you only can make general points about control measures, which can go from the source in the transmission route or at a human host, and you have to know the local situation to know which control measure is most effective. Then you have the intervention at the source, that might be isolation of infected animals. So we had it about the hardware infection, but one method to control hardware infections in herds is herd management. Keep for example cattle and sheep separated, then you have no cross infection between the two. That already indicates that you have no that the route through the environment will be very minor in these cases, and direct transmission might be more important in case of hardware infections. This is what we do in the Netherlands. We treat animals, we do not vaccinate them, because then we cannot follow them by serological methods. For example, diary fever, we follow the herds with bullock milk ELISA, and then we cannot vaccinate them because that would be interfere. We treat them and it works very, very well. Okay, and then we have the vaccination for cattle, pigs and dogs. And feral animals, you can trap them, you can kill them, and you can take care that they do not enter your direct environment, do not get access to your food. And actually, I would like to end here.